Well, good morning. Good morning. There I am. Well, welcome to Slate Belt Church. Thank you for being here today. My name is Steve. I'm the pastor here. Today is Resurrection Sunday, and He is risen.
He is risen.
Amen. Praise the Lord for that. We serve a risen Savior. Amen. Well, listen, we have a lot planned here for today. I'm going to go over a few announcements as we start, and then we'll get to worship. You can find many of these in your bulletin. Please do remember that we have no kids club or teen group tonight, so be aware of that if you would please. Nothing is going on later this evening. Just enjoy your family here today if you would please. There is some things here with lawn maintenance. If you could help us out with that, we would appreciate that. Softball sign-up sheet, we have a QR code there for you. Ladies Bible study will resume April 10th. There's some information there. Be aware of the men's breakfast. Giving statements. There are still a bunch of giving statements through the double doors on the Welcome Center desk. And if you have not picked up your giving statement for this year, make sure you do so. Clothes closet and some other stuff here. Ladies prayer circle. All right, lots of information. Read that at your leisure if you would. Now, on a lighter note, a big thank you for all of you who came out and for the breakfast and supported us there, all the hard work. If you do have stuff downstairs, crock pots or something like that, make sure you pick that up after the service, please, all right? We don't want it loitering around for the next month getting moldy, all right? Just on a lighter note here before I pray, I think there was a conspiracy amongst the women. If you are happening to wear a shirt like this, would you please stand? So there's 10 or 15 of us here throughout the building, I think. So you know what? You may be seated. You know, ladies, there is this thing called payback. Number two, it doesn't matter about the shirt, it's about who wears it best. And we all know who that is. That is Thatcher Flanagan right there. Anyhow, listen, it's good to have fun at the house of God. I was totally snookered. I had no idea. I'm like, why is she so obsessive about me wearing the shirt? What's the deal? It's got to be that one. So anyhow, well, listen, why don't we go to prayer right now? We'll quiet our hearts and we'll start worship this morning. Father, thank you so much for who you are. Father, thank you for, Lord, the historical fact that your Son has risen from the grave and that all of the implications that affect us today because of that. Father, we are here recipients of grace and mercy we do not deserve. And Lord, we're really onlookers to this great plan of salvation that you've worked out through history as you've loved us. And for your glory, you sent your Son to die and to forgive and to restore this broken relationship that we've had with you. And Lord, in this life and through all eternity, we are given this everlasting, this eternal life that we will enjoy as we are with our Lord. So, Father, this morning, I pray that you would meet with us, that we would quiet our hearts. And, Lord, there's so many distractions that can happen. Father, I pray that you would minimize those and that we would just worship you, that we would be clean before you. And as we hear the Word of God taught, we would be receptive. Father, thank you so much for who you are. In Jesus' name, amen.
Good morning. Welcome once again to our celebration of the resurrection of our Savior. Please stand and join with us as we celebrate and as we sing.
My Savior, waiting the coming day, Jesus, my Lord. From the grave he arose with a mighty triumph for his foes. He rules a victor from the dark domain, and he lives forever with his saints to reign. He rules, he rules, hallelujah, Christ rose. Inly they watch his bed, Jesus my Savior. Vainly they seal the dead, Jesus my Lord. Up from the grave he arose, with a mighty triumph for his foes. He arose a victor from the dark domain, and he lives forever with his saints. Keep his prey, Jesus my Savior. He tore the bars away, Jesus my Lord. Up from the grave he arose, with a mighty triumph for his foes. He arose a victor from the dark domain, and he lives forever with his saints to reign. From the grave he arose, with a mighty triumph for his foes. He arose a victor from the dark domain, and he lives forever with his saints to reign. He arose, hallelujah, Christ arose.
Amen.
Jesus bled and died for me. I see his wound, his hands, his feet. My Savior on that cursed tree. His body bound and drenched in tears, he laid him down in Joseph's tomb. The entrance sealed by heavy stone. Messiah still and all. Praise the name of the Lord our God. Oh, praise this name forevermore. For endless days we will sing your praise. Oh, Lord our God. On the third, at break of dawn, the Son of Heaven rose again. Oh, trampled death, where is your sting. The angels brought for Christ the King. He shall return in robes of white, the blazing sun shall pierce the night, and I will rise among the saints, my gaze transfixed on Jesus' face.
Please be seated.
I'd like to read some scripture with you. If you'd like to, you can take your Bible, Matthew chapter 28. Matthew chapter 28. Verse 1 says this, "Now after the Sabbath, toward the dawn of the first day of the week, Mary Magdalene and the other Mary went to see the tomb. And behold, there was a great earthquake, for an angel of the Lord descended from heaven and came and rolled back the stone and sat on it. His appearance was like lightning and his clothing white as snow. And for fear of him, the guards trembled and became like dead men. But the angel said to the women, 'Do not be afraid, for I know that you seek Jesus who was crucified. He is not here, for he has risen. As he said, come see the place where he lay. Then go quickly and tell his disciples that he has risen from the dead. And behold, he is going before you to Galilee, and there you will see him. See, I've told you.' So they departed quickly from the tomb with fear and great joy and ran to tell the disciples. And behold, Jesus met them and said, 'Greetings.' And they came up and took hold of his feet and worshiped him. Then Jesus said to them, 'Do not be afraid. Go and tell my brothers to go to Galilee, and there they will see me.'" I'd like to, at this time, have a special called Rise Again. You allow this to minister to your hearts.
Go ahead, drive the nails in my hands, laugh at me where you stand. Go ahead and say it isn't me. The day will come when you will see. 'Cause I'll rise again. There's no power on earth can tie me down. Yes, I'll rise again. Death can't keep me in the ground. Go ahead and mark my name. My love for you is still the same. Go ahead and bury me. Very soon I will be free. 'Cause I'll rise again. There's no power on earth can tie me down. Yes, I'll rise again. Death can't keep me in the ground. Go ahead and say I'm dead and gone, but you will see that you were wrong. Go ahead, try to hide the sun, but all will see that I'm the one. 'Cause I'll rise. There's no power on earth can tie me down. Yes, I'll rise again. Death can't keep me in the ground. 'Cause I'll back. Yes, I'll come again. Come to take my people back. Yes, I'll come again. Come to take my people back. Come to take my people back.
Amen.
Amen. Isn't it assuring to know that we serve a risen Savior, that he's not in the ground, and that he's paid the penalty for our sin? I'm going to ask the men to come forward for the offering. Let's pray. Dear Heavenly Father, we thank you for what you have done for us. We certainly don't deserve the price that was paid on Calvary. But we are thankful that you have conquered death and that you are no longer in the ground, but you are interceding for us, Lord, that one day we can look forward to eternity with you. Lord, we just thank you for your goodness to us. We thank you for the people that we have here worshiping with us this morning, and we just ask that you would be glorified in our worship and everything that is said and done as part of this service, Lord. We also want to bring some requests before you, Lord, and we think of the Knorr family and the passing of their son, Tom, but we have assurance in knowing that he is with you at this time, Lord. But we ask you might comfort them and strengthen them and just encourage them through this difficult time. We pray for Doris Martin, who's continuing to go through some health needs, Lord, and we know that you are the great physician, that you can provide healing. So we just ask that you would touch her body. And for John Bronishevsky, Lord, we thank you for the progress that we've seen made, that he's actually leaving the hospital. So we just ask that you would continue to provide healing, comfort family, and that you might be glorified through it as well, Lord. And we think of Marilyn Storrs, that you might provide continued recovery for her, that you would touch her body and provide healing, Lord. We ask you would use this service, Lord, to glorify you, that we could praise you and thank you for the price that was paid on the cross for us, but that your son is no longer in the grave, but he is risen. For it's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Silent in the ground,
this body born for heaven's crown. On that bright and glorious day, in heaven opened up the grave. He's alive and risen indeed. Oh, praise Him for the mercy tree. Death has died, love has won. Hallelujah, hallelujah. Jesus Christ is overcome. He has risen from the dead. Death has died, love has won. Hallelujah, hallelujah. Jesus Christ is overcome. He has risen from the dead. Oh, one day soon we'll see His face. Every tear He'll wipe away. No more pain or suffering. Praise Him for the mercy tree. Death has died, love has won. Hallelujah, hallelujah. Jesus Christ is overcome. Risen from the dead. Death has died, love has won. Hallelujah, hallelujah. Jesus Christ is overcome. He has risen from the dead.
Amen. Because of that mercy tree, we live in a victorious day. Jesus says this, John 11, I am the resurrection and the life. Whoever believes in me, though he die, yet shall he live. And everyone who lives and believes in me shall never die. Do you believe this? John 14, he says, let not your heart be troubled. Believe in God, believe also in me. In my Father's house are many mansions. If it were not so, I would have told you, I go to prepare a place for you. And if I go and prepare a place, I will come again and take you unto myself, that where I am, you may be also. Philippians 3, but our citizenship is in heaven, and from it we await a Savior, the Lord Jesus Christ, who will transform our lowly body to be like His glorious body by the power that enables Him even to subject all things to Himself. 1 Corinthians 15, the last enemy to be destroyed is death, for God has put all things in subjection under His feet. But when it says all things are in subjection, it's plain that He is accepted. When the perishable puts on the imperishable, and the mortal puts on immortality, then shall come to pass the saying that is written, death is swallowed up in victory. O death, where is your victory? O death, where is your sting? The sting of death is sin, and the power of sin is the law. But thanks be to God who gives us the victory through our Lord Jesus Christ. Amen. Would you stand with me as we sing, O Glorious Day?
One day when heaven was filled with His praises, one day when sin was as black as could be, Jesus came forth to be born of a virgin, dwelt among men, my example is He. Word became flesh and the light shined among us, His glory revealed. Living He loved me, dying He saved me, buried He carried my sins far away, rising He justified freely forever. One day He's coming, oh glorious day, oh glorious day. One day they led Him up Calvary's mountain, they nailed Him to die on a tree. Suffering anguish, despised and rejected, bearing all sins, my Redeemer is He. Hands that healed nations, stretched out on a tree, and He took the nails for me. Living He loved me, dying He saved me, buried He carried my sins far away, rising He justified freely forever. One day He's coming, oh glorious day, oh glorious day. One day the grave could conceal Him no longer, one day the stone rolled away from the door. He arose, oh, the death He had conquered, and now He's ascended, my Lord evermore. Death could not hold Him, the grave could not keep Him from rising again. Living He loved me, dying He saved me, buried He carried my sins far away, rising He justified freely forever. One day He's coming, oh glorious day, oh glorious day. Day. One day the trumpet will sound for His coming. One day the skies with His glory will shine. Wonderful day, my beloved one. Savior Jesus is mine. Living He loved me, dying He saved me, buried He carried my sins far away. Rising, He justified, freely forever. One day He's coming, oh glorious day. Living, He loved me, dying, He saved me. Buried, He carried my sins far away. Rising, He justified, freely forever. One day He's coming, oh glorious day, oh glorious day. Suddenly articulate, with a thousand tongues to lift one cry. Then from north to south and east to west, we'd hear cries, be magnified. Echoing His eminence, His name would burst from sea and sky, from rivers to the mountain tops, we'd hear cries, be magnified. Oh, Christ, be magnified, let His praise arise. Christ, be magnified in me and all. Christ, be magnified from the altar of my life. Christ, be magnified in me. Every creature finds its inmost melody, and every human heart its native cry. Then in one enraptured hymn of praise, we'll sing Christ, be magnified. Be magnified, let His praise arise. Christ, be magnified in me. Oh, Christ, be magnified from the altar of my life. Christ, be magnified in me. Bow down to idols, I'll stand strong and worship You. And if it puts me in the fire, I'll rejoice 'cause You're there too. I won't be formed by feelings. I hold fast to what is true. And if the cross brings transformation, then I'll be crucified with you. 'Cause death is just a doorway into resurrection life. And if I join you in your sufferings, then I'll join you when you rise. When you return in glory with all the angels and the saints, my heart will still be singing and my song will be the same. I won't bow down to idols, I'll stand strong and worship you. If it puts me in the fire, I'll rejoice 'cause you're there too. I won't be formed by feelings, I hold fast to what is true. And if the cross brings transformation, then I'll be crucified with you. 'Cause death is just a doorway into resurrection life. If I join you in your sufferings, then I'll join you when you rise. When you return in glory with all the angels and the saints, my heart will still be singing and my song will be the same. Oh, Christ be magnified, let his praise arise. Christ be magnified in me, and oh, Christ be magnified from the altar of my life. Christ be magnified in me, and oh, Christ be magnified, let his praise arise. Christ be magnified in me, and oh, Christ be magnified from the altar of my life. Christ be magnified in me.
Thank you so much. Praise God. Please be seated.
Amen. Take your Bible, if you would, Romans chapter 8. At this time, children may be dismissed to junior church. Romans chapter 8. Well, church family, I just have to say I have loved worshiping with you this morning. Amen? Amen. I tell you, the Spirit is here. Music team, thank you so much for directing our hearts to worship this morning. Once you found that, let's go ahead and bow in prayer. Father, we come before you. Lord, we are just in awe as we have sang these beautiful songs. Thank you for the gift of music. Lord, thank you that you have created the church to be a body with all these different moving parts. And it was evident that people were exercising their spiritual gifts this morning. Father, thank you for that. Father, thank you for everything else that's happening in this place today. Lord, our desire is to meet with you. Thank you for so many family and friends that are probably with us here today. And Lord, we pray that you would teach us from your word. Lord, thank you for the cross of Christ. Thank you for raising him from the dead. And Father, thank you for your Spirit that connects the power of the cross to us. We give you the service at this time in Jesus' name. Amen. Well, I imagine that we have a lot of family and friends that are visiting with us today. and welcome here. If you are new to church or new to Christianity and you're not exactly sure what is all about this resurrection stuff that we've been singing about, let me tell you that it's very important to us, and it's important to us for a lot of fundamental reasons to our faith. And there is a lot of backstory to this whole idea of the resurrection of Christ. I'd like to share just a little bit of that with you before we get to Romans 8. So I know about our time. I'm going to speak half of this and then get to Romans 8, and we're going to dig down into this a little bit. But I'd like to share a little bit of the backstory as we start this morning of why we celebrate the resurrection. Why is it a thing here at Slate Belt Church that Jesus rose from the dead? Why is there such excitement? Why are we singing about this? The Bible tells us that God created human beings. And he created human beings in his image. We have a body, a soul, and a spirit. And we are able to have a relationship with our Creator. And because we have this image of God, we are able to live somewhere forever. This is unlike any other thing that God has created. And our God is good, the Bible teaches us. And he wants human beings to thrive. And he has built us to find satisfaction in him and being with him. So if we go way back in human history, the first man and woman, Adam and Eve, they were created in this perfect setting, the Garden of Eden. They lived in perfect harmony with each other and with Creator God. And they found their purpose and their peace as they lived in this garden, as they followed the things that God asked them to do. And then Adam and Eve chose to disobey God. In other words, they chose to put themselves first. They broke the commandments of God, and that's called sin. And folks, the Bible teaches clearly that sin separates human beings from God. God is holy. In other words, God is sinless, and he is righteous, and he cannot come near sin. And from that point, in the garden with the first man and woman, human beings were born far from God, separate from him, with this ingrained sin nature that causes them to love themselves above everything else. The Bible also records that in chapter 3, you don't have to turn there, of Romans, that there is none righteous. That little two-year-old that you think is so beautiful and precious, the Bible says she is not righteous, but she loves herself above all things. Have you found that out? We can see this. The Bible says that there is none righteous, no, not one. We're all sinners. The Bible also says that the wages of sin is death. Folks, can I tell you, I am so sick of death. Aren't you? The Bible says because of sin, physical death has come upon human beings. In fact, everything is dying. Things are not getting better and better, believe it or not. They're getting worse and worse. But the Bible also says that this sin of Adam and Eve affected us spiritually. We're all born dead. We're all born far from God. Now, I said at first that we're created to live forever, and we will somewhere. But we will live either with God in harmony or far from God in anguish. And so as we grow up, there is this sense that comes upon us way down in our soul, way down in our spirit, that we know somehow we are separate from our Creator God. It's just there. But the Bible also records that our God is good. Aren't you glad God is good? He did not leave us to a purposeless existence and then destruction afterwards. He began to work out from the beginning, in fact, before time, he began to work out his plan to put you and me back into a right relationship with him. If sin separates you from God, and you've been born that way, if sin will condemn you to be separate from God in anguish forever, then that sin must be dealt with. And we can't do it ourselves. The Bible reveals that one of the core attributes of God's nature is love. And I'm talking about a love that is self-sacrificing, self-giving, and it's why human beings can act like that just a little bit. And so God, out of love, and that's what his love does, he gave himself. He sent Jesus, very God, the sinless, perfect Son of God, to live a perfect life, to meet that high demand of perfection that God expects. Jesus had to be one of us to save us. The Bible reveals that Jesus was born a human, able to feel the temptation that we can. He lived a sinless life. Hebrews tells us Jesus was holy, harmless, undefiled, and separate from sinners. That means as Jesus lived his life, he never sinned. He never stole, he never lied, he never had an impure thought. He never slandered or lusted. He loved the Lord his God with all his heart, soul, and mind. And he loved his neighbor as himself. All that God expected man to do to have a relationship with him, Jesus did perfectly. He is our representative. But our sin demands punishment. And that's why Jesus came. Jesus came to take that punishment, that sin upon himself. Philippians tells us that Jesus emptied himself by taking the form of a servant and being born in the likeness of men. He humbled himself to the point of death, even the death of the cross. That means that Jesus died for the sins of the world, those very sins that separate you and God forever. 1 Peter 3, for Christ also suffered for sins, the righteous for the unrighteous, that he may bring us to God, being put to death in the flesh, but being made alive in the spirit. John 10, Jesus says, no one takes my life from me, but I lay it down of my own accord. And folks, the wonderful fact that the Bible teaches is that Jesus' death was enough. Aren't you glad that Jesus' death was enough? It perfectly satisfied the high demands of God. And we know that God was pleased with Jesus because he did not allow him to stay in the grave, but Jesus was resurrected by resurrection power. John 11, Jesus said, I am the resurrection and the life. He who believes in me, though he die, yet shall he live. And everyone who believes in me will not die. And folks, none of us can come to God without payment, and Jesus made that payment. Since Jesus died and rose again, you can come to Creator God without payment, without punishment, without fear, because Jesus paid it all. He paid your debt, and we come with nothing but belief. As the old hymn says, nothing in my hands I bring, simply to thy cross I cling. So folks, I'll just be real transparent with you, and I've said this several times. I'm 46, I grew up in a pastor's home, I have a bunch of Bible degrees, I've been in ministry most of my life. And I can't comprehend how God can be born of a virgin and take on sin. So what I'm talking about here is not something that I have some type of intellectual firm grasp upon. But rather what God does is he gives us enough stuff that we can understand to help us in things that we can't. It's called faith. Faith means simply to trust. The most famous verse in the Bible, for God so loved the world. I can understand love, and I certainly believe God exists. For God so loved the world that he gave. I was 14 years old in the church parsonage at night on my knees looking out at the window at the moon. And in a moment, I was overcome by the reality of God. And somehow, I needed to believe this, and I did believe this. And folks, here at Slate Belt Church, we're here not just to celebrate this person who I'm sure created us and is up there somewhere, But rather, we are celebrating the resurrection of one who we do not fully understand, but we have a complete revelation of who he is. And we've taken it by faith and all the work that God has done. And our hope here is not only that you've enjoyed some music and it's been great, but rather that you hear our heart. We're here not just because of fuzzy feelings or because somehow we just like to gather. We're here because we truly do believe that Jesus Christ is Lord. He died for us, and he rose again by the power of the Father. Well, Steve, how can I tangibly put my hands around this? Like, is there anything about the resurrection that I can feel today, that I can sense today? Is this something that you just believe, and when you die, you hope you believe the right things, and you guys obviously do believe you believe the right things. Is there anything more than that? And I would say there is. And our text today helps us put hands around, tangibly understand the power of the resurrection. So I invite you, if you would, to look down at Romans chapter 8. And look at verse 11. Romans chapter 8 and verse 11. If the spirit of him who raised Jesus from the dead, if the spirit of him, the Father, who raised Jesus from the dead dwells in you, he who raised Christ Jesus from the dead will also give life to your mortal bodies. Now, mortal bodies are bodies that you have right now. Well, how does he do that? Through his spirit that dwells in you. This means that we are able to experience the effects of the resurrection of Christ now. Where? In our bodies. Now, not a feeling, but something much more powerful. Let me explain to you what I mean. 2 points. I'll get to the first one. Look with me, if you would, at verse 14. For all who are led by the Spirit. Now, the Spirit is a key factor here. For all who are led by the Spirit of God are the sons of God. For you did not receive the spirit of slavery to fall back into fear, but you have received the spirit of adoption as sons, by whom we cry, Abba, Father. The Spirit himself bears witness with our spirit that we are the children of God. And if children, then heirs, and heirs of God, and fellow heirs with Christ, provided we suffer with him in order that we may be glorified with him. Let's stop there. Paul is saying that the believers have the Spirit of God indwelling them. This is how the resurrection of Christ affects you today. How can I know that the resurrection of Christ is real? Well, here's one foundational, pivotal way, because the Spirit of God can reside inside of you. And instead of God being your enemy, he's your Father. Instead of running from God, you run to him. There's a sense that you will always be his. Our text says, you cry, Abba, Father. That means daddy. You know, I love seeing all these little kids around here. I don't have little kids anymore. I loved it when my little children would crawl up into my arms, and they just do that little snuggle thing with you. And that you can just sense that there's such trust and love. That's what Paul says the Spirit of God, when you believe, begins to do in you. How do I know that the resurrection of Christ happened? Because the Bible says. Well, is there a way that I can feel it, experience it through the Spirit? The Bible says as soon as you accept Christ, the Spirit indwells in you, and he begins to do something inside of you. You have the Spirit. The Spirit of unites our hearts with this unbreakable bond. But Paul's going to fill this out, and here's where it really gets tangible and powerful, okay? Look at verse 12. So then, brothers, we are debtors not to the flesh to live according to the flesh. For if you live according to the flesh, you will die. But if by the Spirit, you put to death the deeds of the body, you will live. For all who are led by the Spirit of God are sons of God. For you did not receive the spirit of slavery to fall back into fear, but received the spirit of adoption to cry, Abba, Father. So how can I tangibly take hold? How do I know that the resurrection of Christ has happened? Because you have the Spirit. And Paul fills that out. Because the Spirit has all of you. You want to know for sure that God is alive and that He rules and reigns. You allow the Spirit of God to have all of you. The Spirit of God will positively be convicting and transforming your life into the ways of righteousness. And folks, I got to tell you, this is the most positive evidence you can have. In fact, Paul is going to go so far to say that if the Spirit of God is not conforming you into the image of Christ, then you do not have the Spirit of God. Look with me, if you would, at verse 1. There is therefore now no condemnation for those who are in Christ Jesus. For the law of the Spirit of life has set you free in Christ Jesus. Now, what did He set you free from? From the law of sin and death. For God has done what the law, weakened by the flesh, could not do. By sending His Son in the likeness of sinful flesh and sin, He condemned sin in the flesh, in order that the righteous requirements of the law might be filled in us, who walk not according to the flesh, but according to the Spirit. For those who live according to the flesh set their minds on the things of the flesh. But those who live according to the Spirit set their minds on the things of the Spirit. For to set the mind on the flesh is death, but to set the mind on the Spirit is life and peace. For the mind that is set on the flesh is hostile to God, for it does not submit to God's law. Indeed, it cannot. Those who are in the flesh cannot please God. You, however, are not in the flesh, but in the Spirit. In fact, the Spirit of God dwells in you. Anyone who does not have the Spirit of Christ does not belong to Him. But if Christ is in you, although the body is dead because of sin, the Spirit is life because of righteousness. If the Spirit of Him who raised Jesus from the dead dwells in you, He who raised Christ from the dead will give life to your mortal bodies. And what type of life is that? It's life that is powerful. The power of Christ through the Spirit of God, through the change of affections, to grow this fruit of the Spirit inside of you, to stop sinning, but to live exactly the way that Christ lived, a holy and pure and spotless life. I'm not talking about sinless perfection, but I'm talking about the way that Jesus is, the holiness of the Father and the holiness of Christ. God intends to grow that inside of you. When you are saved positionally, you are declared sinless. But practically, the Spirit's power is going to work out, convicting and rebuking and changing. He allows the fruit of the Spirit to grow in you. I went through quite a period of time when I doubted my salvation. How could you be in Bible college and doubt your salvation? Well, I did. And one of the most confirming things in my life was not the doctrine that I held to, although that was orthodox. It was right. The most confirming thing in my life that I indeed was a child of God and the resurrection of Christ did indeed affect me was the Spirit of God doing its refining, rebuking, cleaning, teaching, empowering work. Folks, has that happened to you? Can you look back in your life and you can see evidence of the resurrection, not because of what you intellectually assent to, but because the power of Christ through the Spirit is inside of you? Has that happened? Look with me, if you would, at Romans chapter 6. Romans chapter 6, look with me at verse 5. Romans 6:5, for if we, talking about believers, have been united with him in his death. So when you believe in Christ, what God does is he takes what Christ has done and he applies it to your account. You are united with him. You identify with him. We did a baptism a couple of weeks ago, and we identify with Christ as he goes down into the water. This is how he died. Whatever happened to him happened to me. I died with Christ, and we pull them back up out of the water. And what does it say here? For if we have been united with him in a death like his, we shall certainly be united with him in a resurrection like his. That is not fair to God. How is it that me and you, sinless creatures who are born far from God, saying, I don't want this man to rule over me, somehow get all of that? We get it because God is good and God is love. How does he apply it to our account? Through the Spirit. Look at this. If we have been united with him in a death like his, we shall certainly be united with him in a resurrection like his. Steve, how can I grasp this? I want to believe it. Well, you believe it because the Spirit's inside of you and it begins to work. Look at verse 6. We know that our old self was crucified with him in order that the body of sin in you might be brought to nothing. That the condemnation hanging over you be brought to nothing. And so that we would no longer be enslaved to sin. For one who has died has been set free from sin. Now, if we've died with Christ, we believe we will also live with him. We know that Christ being raised from the dead will never die again. Death has no longer dominion over him. For the death he died to sin once for all, but the life he lives to God. So you also must consider yourselves dead to sin and alive to God in Christ Jesus. Let not sin reign in your mortal body to obey its passions. Do not present your members as sins of instruments of unrighteousness, but present yourselves to God as those who have been brought from death to life, and your members to God as instruments of righteousness, for sin will have no dominion over you, since you are not under the law, but under grace. How do I know that the resurrection of Christ is real? Because sin used to have dominion. But not anymore, because the Spirit of God indwells me. Folks, it empowers me, it convicts me, it bears me along when I am weak. Folks, this is the greatest evidence to the individual to know in their heart of hearts that Jesus did indeed rise from the grave. So my question here today, this is a simple thought. Have you seen the Spirit of God do a work in your life? I'm not saying, did you get lucky on the golf course? I'm not saying, did you throw up a prayer as you were speeding down the interstate that you wouldn't get a ticket and you didn't? I'm saying, did you take the Bible and say, these are the evidences of righteousness? I used to hate, but I don't anymore. I used to lie, but I don't anymore. I used to think God was my enemy, but there's something inside of me, this affection for him that drives me to worship, that drives me to his word. Is that inside of you? It's amazing that God not only does all the work necessary for our salvation, but he says, just because I'm good, I'm going to leave my presence here, and it's going to do this supernatural work. And folks, it doesn't matter how old you are. You can be a 3-year-old kid and accept Christ and see change come into your life. At the end of this month, we're going to do a baptism, and I've got 4 or 5 little kids, little ones. And I got to make sure the baptism is warm, because they ain't going to go in there if it's cold. I know that. But I talk to these parents and I say, why do you want this to happen? And it's wonderful to hear. My little 5-year-old, my little 6-year-old, this is the way they were. But I got to tell you, they just love Jesus now. And I've actually seen a difference in their life. Folks, it can happen. I love the fact that I have seen men and women who are advanced in years. Could we say that? Finally come to Christ. And the peace that they have, and the joy that they have, and they said, man, I didn't know I could have this. I've assented intellectually to the church dogma that, yeah, Jesus exists. But when I finally got broken in front of him and the Spirit of God began to do its work, this is real. What does the song say? You ask me how I know he lives. He lives within my heart. Now, perhaps you're standing here, sitting here today, and you're saying, Steve, this sounds like a bunch of spooky stuff. I get it. You listen to this bearded, balded guy up here talking. But we're not here because we simply are ascending to a bunch of words on a paper. We're here because there is something alive inside of us, something that we can't explain. If that's a phone, I'm going to tell you. Is that a deacon? Oh, my goodness. So this is a running joke. So in every service that I speak, where the Spirit of God begins to move, phones go off, this goes off, that goes off. It's all right. Anyway, have you seen the Spirit of God do a work in your life? Be encouraged. Be thankful. This is only because of the resurrection of Christ. So sometimes these weighty truths seem so ungraspable. How do I put my hands around the death of Christ to appreciate it for what it is? And I submit to you this morning, this is a simple truth. I know we have a lot of people here, perhaps you're believers, perhaps not. The power of the resurrection is seen today through the Spirit of God changing believers into the likeness of Christ. In fact, the Apostle Paul warns us not to disrespect the work of Christ. As we take the Lord's table, we are to be clean with him. He says here, if we would judge ourselves, we would not be judged. And so while we celebrate today the victory of Jesus, does he indeed, Christian, have victory in your life? Is the Spirit of God having all of you? When he convicts, do you repent? When he prompts, do you listen? When he leads, do you follow? How wrong would it be to attend this wonderful worship service that we've had about the resurrection of Jesus and yet ignore Christ in you, the hope of glory, ignore the Spirit of God who wants to work in you every day? Folks, we all have struggles of faith, but this is foundational. And today, we can think through our life and say, you know, Jesus does indeed rule. Philippians 3, God hath highly exalted him and given him a name above every name, that at the name of Jesus, every knee will bow, every tongue will confess that Jesus is Lord to the glory of God the Father. And what God expects of you today is to submit to that and to say, yes, he is my Lord. I do know him. I know that I know him because the Spirit of God indwells me. And to understand that we must value this tangible presence of Christ in us today. Do not grieve the Spirit. You love him, you honor him, you allow the Spirit of God to take this word day by day and grow you and change you. But folks, the appeal here, I went to church till I was 14 years old before I finally accepted Christ. My dad was a pastor. Sunday morning, Sunday night, Sunday school, Wednesday night. Just because you come to church doesn't mean you're in the family. Jesus did live and he did rise from the dead, and there are people all over this congregation that can testify that he's real because the Spirit of God indwells them. But our plea to you is, do you truly believe? I did a memorial service here this week, and I said, I believe if this person could come back from heaven, he would simply say one thing, believe. For God so loved the world. Steve, it's difficult. I know it's difficult, but there's enough here that you can grab onto to help you have faith. If the Spirit of God is enlightening you and convicting you, you do not turn that off. God loves you. He has paid the price for your sin that you are born with that separates you from God and from others. And you will, if you do not accept him, you will stand before God one day and he's going to say, I don't know you. Doesn't matter what you did in church. Doesn't matter how many times you've been baptized. Doesn't matter how much money you've given. If you do not accept what Christ has done on the cross through simple faith, forever you will live apart from him. So I'm here just a simple old preacher saying that God looked down into my life when I was 14 years old and he did not have to. But because he loved me and he gave his son for me, he said, Steve, all you need to do is believe. Turn from your sins and cast yourself on Christ. And from that moment, the power of the resurrection has been evident in my life. Not every day, but it's been there. And folks, that's available to you. Folks, I've so appreciated the worship here this morning as we lifted our voices. We serve a risen Savior. And one day we will be with him and be like him. And I hope that you have enjoyed today and that's your heart as well. Father, we come before you. Lord, I thank you that you love us. And Lord, I thank you for the moving body parts of this church. Lord, I thank you that Christ has indeed died and rose again. And Father, we have tangible evidence through the Spirit of God. And Lord, for that we give you praise. God the Father, we give you praise for the Spirit. We give you praise for the changed lives here. We give you praise for the changed hearts as people have turned from darkness into light. We give you praise for the young children that's come to faith in you. We give you praise for the marriages that have been helped. Father, we give you praise most of all that this church has been salt and light in this community, and it's because the Spirit of Almighty God indwells us, empowers us. Lord, let us not grieve the Spirit. Let us submit to it. Let us honor you as you dwell among us. Father, thank you that you conquered death. Thank you that today we are called to remember that death was arrested. It was conquered. We give you praise. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen. Let's stand and close with Death Was Arrested.
In my sorrow and dead in my sin, lost without hope with no place to begin, your love made a way to let mercy come in. When death was arrested and my life began, ash was redeemed, only beauty remains. My orphan heart was given a name. My mourning grew quiet, my feet rose to dance. When death was arrested and my life began, oh, your grace so free washes over me. You have made me new. Now life begins with you. It's your endless love pouring down on us. You have made us new. Now life begins with. From my chains, I'm a prisoner no more. My shame was a ransom he faithfully bore. He canceled my debt and he called me his friend. When death was arrested and my life began, oh, your grace so free washes over me. You have made me new. Now life begins with you. It's your endless Savior displayed on a criminal's cross. Darkness rejoiced as though heaven had lost. But then Jesus arose with our freedom in hand. That's when death was arrested and my life began. Your grace so free washes over me. You have made me new. Now life begins with you. It's your endless love pouring down on us. You have made us new. Now life begins with you. Oh, we're free, free, forever we're free. Come join the song for the redeemed. Yes, we're free, free, forever, amen. When death was arrested and my life began. Yes, we're free, free, forever we're free. Come join the song for the redeemed. Yes, we're free, free, forever, amen. When death was arrested and my life began. When death was arrested and my life began. When death was arrested and my life began.
Amen. Folks, it has been good to be at the house of God. Amen? Amen. Listen, I just hope that you have a wonderful resurrection day with family. Folks, thank you so much for being a wonderful church body. The Spirit is here. We give God praise for what He's doing. Amen. Let's go ahead and pray. We'll be dismissed. Remember, there's nothing here this evening. Let's pray. Father, we come before you. Lord, thank you that really our lives began when we accepted you. Father, we look back and see what we used to be. And now we see who we are because of the Spirit. Father, we give you praise for that. Lord, I pray that this church would be known to walking in the Spirit. Father, thank you that we are recipients of grace we do not deserve. Lord, thank you for a risen Savior. In Jesus' name, amen. You are dismissed.